Well, hello everyone, and welcome to Chatterbox Quilts Live for September 2019, September 19th, 2019 to be exact. Thanks for joining me here today and taking some time out of your quilting day to learn about more quilting. If you are with me today and you haven't been with me before, let me introduce myself. I'm Kim Jamieson-Hirst. I'm an online educator. I'm the host of The Quilter's Way. And if you don't know about The Quilter's Way, I encourage you to take a look at it. You can find it at thequiltersway.com. It's the only online quilting membership that combines learning with a fun, supportive community. I wanted to say hello today, a special hello to any of my chatties who are watching. These are members of my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group. So if you're out there, give me a hi in the chat area. And of course, if you're watching me right now anyway, say hello, let me know where you're watching from. And if any of my members of the Quilter's Way are watching, please say hello too, because I know they like to watch live videos and jump in with their helpful comments. So today, we are going to be talking about the scariest technique in quilting. Now, most people are going to say this is free motion quilting. The odd person says something a little bit different, but overwhelmingly, the majority of quilters will talk about free motion quilting as being the scariest technique in quilting. So I want to address that today. And I want to talk about this from the perspective of your mindset, okay? How you view this, your attitude towards it, okay? Because when you think about it, free motion quilting is just another quilting technique, okay? People say it's hard, you know, people say, oh, you shouldn't be afraid to try it. And they say those kind of things like it's not that hard, but that kind of makes you think that it really is hard and that you should be afraid to learn free motion quilting. And really, like I said, it's just another technique. So remember way back when you first started quilting, what did you think about learning to quilt? Did you think it was scary? Did you think it was going to be horrible? I doubt it. Okay, I bet you're excited to learn how to quilt, right? But you were starting at the same place that you may be with free motion quilting, and that is at the beginning, right? So when you're at the beginning of something, you don't know anything about it. You may have some expectations, but you really aren't sure what exactly you're getting into. You might be a little nervous, a little anxious, excited to do that. And so again, thinking back to when you first started quilt, you walked into, you know, your friend's house, your grandmother's place, maybe your mother taught you, maybe you took a class like I did when I first started to learn. And I probably had less knowledge than most people do going into quilting. I really hadn't a clue what it was going to be like, except that I knew that some of my friends did it and they made some really wonderful projects. So I thought, well, why not give it a try? But really, I had no idea how it was going to work at all. So I just listened. I listened to the instructor. I took a class in town in Calgary here, and I just listened to the instructor and I did what she told me basically. And again, it didn't make any sense. I was making an Irish chain, right? One of the typical things you'll make when you first start quilting. And I couldn't figure out how she was chain piecing these things together. It made no sense to me whatsoever, but you know what? It turned out just great. So I just followed along with her, but I learned some really good tips from her too. And some good ways of quilting and some good safety items as well. So the class was great. And like I said, I was a little nervous, a little anxious for taking it, but I was also excited because it was something I wanted to learn. And I thought when I learn it, I'll see if I like it. Because that's what my friends told me, you know, take a class, you'll either like it or you won't like it. So if you like it, well, you know what happens, right? You get obsessed with it. It's quilting all the time. But, and you know, that's what happened to me, obviously. But until you actually get into the nuts and bolts of whatever the technique is you're learning and, you know, go through the proper, I say proper steps, I hate to use that word, but go through the logical step-by-step procedure to do whatever that technique is, and then practice it, because I'm not going to sugarcoat this. You have to practice at any technique to get good, and that includes free motion quilting. So, you know, if you think about taking those steps, learning what you've been taught, practicing those things that you've been taught, you're going to move ahead, and you're probably going to get to be fairly good at whatever it is. Now, I'll give you a caveat. There may be some things you try that you don't like, but that's okay too, because if you try something and you find you don't like it, well, you don't have to do it, right? Nobody says you have to do it. But having said that, I'm going to put free motion quilting in a little bit different category, because if you don't learn how to free motion quilt, well, what does that mean? one of two things. Either you have an awful lot of quilt tops lying around your studio unquilted, and I've been guilty of that, or you're going to take those quilt tops and you're going to pay someone to quilt them for you. Perfectly fine. That's okay too. But I think the majority of quilters like to do their projects right from the beginning all the way through to when they're finished. So let's think that we're those kind of quilters, that we want to learn how to free motion quilt, that we are going to approach it like we do any other technique. We're going to get our mindset, our attitude right about it, okay? It is not really the scariest technique in quilting. It is something that you have to learn. It is something that you have to start at the beginning. And what's wrong with that? Because everything we learn, we start at the beginning, okay? Now, you may be like me, and I've got to admit that I am not the best about asking people for help when I'm having a problem with something or when I don't know something about it. I will go to all kinds of lengths to research it and looking up how to do it on my own, which takes a lot of time and can be quite frustrating. And I got to tell you a story. When I went back to school, well, and the reason I do this is because I think that, you know, I should know it. I think I should already know it. I mean, it's totally illogical, but I think I should already know how to do whatever it is I'm supposed to be learning. I know, makes no sense at all. It's just how my mind works sometimes. And the story I was going to tell you is when I was 30, I went back to university as a mature student, and I finished my degree. I have a bachelor's in French language. And I was going back into the same year I had left, which was third year. I had completed 2 years previously, but that was, you know, 10, 11 years before. And so I was really nervous and really anxious and afraid about going back into university at that level because I thought, I'm not going to know it all. What if I get into class and I don't know all the answers? I don't know what they're teaching me. Here we go again with this illogical thinking, right? And so, of course, my husband, the practical one, put it into perspective and he said, you know, if you already knew what they were teaching you, you wouldn't be taking the classes. Pretty obvious, right? But not to my way of thinking. So you don't have to know everything. You should be without any knowledge, really, if you're going to learn how to do a technique. And you will have an open mind, a good attitude, thinking about it as just any other thing you're going to learn in quilting, because what it's going to do is it's going to allow you to finish those projects. You have all those quilt tops that are lying around. Maybe that's just me, but you know, I know some of you have quilt tops lying around that aren't quilted. And so let's not think about it being so scary. Let's not think about the fact that your first results might not be great, because I'm going to be really honest with you here. Your first results won't be great. Okay. You know, you're not going to sit down and do amazing free motion quilting when you first start. Think back again. What about your first quilt? How did that turn out? Would you do it differently now? Would you have a different result now? I bet you would. Okay. I bet most of us would. So again, practice makes improvement, not perfection. I always say practice makes improvement. Okay. And that's what we're always trying to do, is to improve. So starting off free motion quilting, get your mind around it. Don't be afraid of it, because fear is a stumbling block that's going to stop you cold, whether it's in quilting or in life. If you're afraid of something and you allow that fear to take you over, you'll never move forward. You'll be just stuck there. And we don't want to be stuck when we're talking about free motion quilting or anything else in quilting, really. We want to move past our fears, take it one step at a time, take it slow, realize your first results are not going to be good. Okay? So if you can agree that your first results aren't going to be great, or if you've already been free motion quilting for a while, think back. You know, if your first results weren't great, give me a yes in the chat area there, because I know I'm not the only one in this situation. Okay. And like I said, practice makes improvement. So especially with free motion quilting, you're going to have to practice to get better. No other way around it. It's just the way it goes. All right. So let's move on to some more practical information about free motion quilting. So when you start off doing, again, any technique, having the right tools will really help a lot. And I firmly believe that if you do not have the right tools and you're trying to do something, you are just going to have an awful time with it. You are not going to be successful or as successful as you could be. You're going to be frustrated. You're going to be upset. So let's just get rid of all that right off the top and start off with, I'll say, the right tools. But there are certain tools, and I'm sure some of you have them, that make your free motion quilting easier. The first thing, of course, would be a sewing machine. Okay, that's kind of an obvious one. When I talk about things, I often forget to mention the sewing machine because I just assume. But yes, you need a sewing machine. And there are some sewing machines that will help you a little bit more than others will. So it depends on what type of machine you have. Some machines have a speed control on them. Okay, pretty much all the newer models have a speed control on them. And that allows you to set the speed of the machine so the needle goes up and down at a consistent rate. And what that allows you to do is that you can set that rate, usually probably about halfway, you know, about medium speed. And then that allows you to press your foot pedal all the way down, hold it down, and that'll just keep the needle going up and down at a consistent rate. Typically, if you don't have a speed control on your machine, it's not like you can't do free motion quilting or anything, but it means you have to think about your foot pedal because you're trying to keep your foot pedal, you know, your foot, I should say, at a certain angle, if you will, on the foot pedal, a certain pressure on the foot pedal to keep that needle going consistently and not slow, 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 and then fast, 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 and slow, slow, and fast, fast, fast. So I find that the speed control on a machine, if you have one of those, really helps a lot. Okay, so if you've got one of those and you haven't tried this before, try setting it about medium speed, put your foot all the way down, see how that needle's going, and then you can either, you know, increase it or decrease it depending on how fast you like to move your hands, because that's the second thing you need to do when you're free motion quilting is, of course, you are the one moving that quilt around on the machine bed, right? So it's that dance between your hands, how fast they're going, how fast the machine is going. And when that all clicks together, that's when your free motion quilting becomes much less of an effort. And again, it takes practice. And I can't tell you when you're going to hit that perfect balance there, but you will. Okay, if you haven't already done that, you will. At some point in time, it just happens. I know that sounds, it's not very helpful, but it does. It just happens as you practice and you keep going along. You all of a sudden just feel that everything's moving together in a great way. And to help things move together in a great way, you need two other items. So Let's something else I always forget about, but I'm going to talk about the first two I'm thinking of. So one of them is something to grip that quilt and move it around, because I talked about how you're going to be moving that quilt around. So what will you use to do that? You're going to use your hands, right? Machine's not doing it. You are, so you're going to use your hands. And so what should you have that will help? Well, something that's grippy. So if you have some gloves, so you can either use like gardening gloves are great, machingers, you've probably seen those at your quilt store. I like to use those as well. There are all different kinds of products on the market that you can use. I tend to like the gloves. Some people find them hot, so whatever works for you, but something that gives you a good grip on that quilt so you can move it around. Okay, that's one thing. And the other thing is the opposite. It's a slippery thing, something you want to put on the bed of your sewing machine that's going to keep your quilt sliding along easily. And that can be something like the Supreme Slider you may have heard of, or there's a, what's the other one called? It's so steady, I always forget the name of it. But it's another one. It's very similar to the Supreme Slider. There are sprays you can use, like silicone sprays you can put on the bed of your machine. I'd be careful with those and test a very small area just to make sure it doesn't discolor your machine or do anything to the finish on it. But you can do that as well. But something that helps your quilt slide along easily is really helpful. So you got the gripping where you can move it, and then the slippery part underneath that allows it to move along easily. Something else you might want to consider that one of my members in the Quilter's Way talked about, and I've seen this online as well, and you may have as well, is when you're quilting a big quilt on your machine and you have that quilt that's going over your machine bed and maybe falling on the floor and it's pulling, you know, they get pretty heavy. So to avoid that pull, you can do a few things. Of course, you can have another table behind your sewing table to hold that bulk of the quilt when you're quilting it. Or another thing that's really cool is you can get bungee cords. You can put them up in your ceiling. In my studio here, I have panels I can push up and actually put hooks up there and hang bungee cords from them if I want to. Or in some ceilings, you might put hooks in. It depends on how much you want to get into this, but you might even consider, I'm not sure if they're strong enough, but command hooks, perhaps. Those are ones by 3M that you can put on and come off your walls and that. I don't know if they're going to hold that much weight or not, but in any case, you want to have bungee cords coming down from the ceiling with clamps on the end, and so you can clamp your quilt and it keeps the weight up and allows you to move it around easily, and you don't have that pull of it going off the table. So that's another good suggestion that will help with that bulk of the quilt moving through, especially when you get into big quilts. Okay, the other thing I wanted to mention here that I always forget, it seems like, is the the foot on your sewing machine, right? Now, I have a couple videos, two or three videos actually, on my YouTube channel that talks about how to set up your machine, whether it's a Janome, I think it's a Janome 9400 I have a video on. I have one just talking about any type of domestic machine. I also talk about the 9450, the Janome 9450, and the different free motion feet that it comes with, because it comes with a bunch of them. But basically, you're looking at a darning foot. That's what you use for free motion quilting. And so most machines will have a darning foot with them. If not, you can typically buy generic ones or ones specially made for your machine at your dealer. And if you're lucky, you have ones that are open-toed, because I like those. So it looks like a little U sort of, and you can see where you're quilting a little easier. But you want that on your machine, and of course you want to drop your feed dog. So again, look at those videos, go to my YouTube channel, just look under Chatterbox Quilts on YouTube, and you'll be able to look under Free Motion Quilting and find those videos. So that'll give you a detailed description of what to use and how to set up your machine. So that's the nitty-gritty of things. So once you've got your machine set up, well, what are you going to do then? Well, you're going to start free motion quilting, right? And what do you want to start free motion quilting on? Not your best quilt, right? Because that's the other thing people talk about. They don't want to ruin their quilt. And they always say this, I don't want to ruin my quilt. Well, believe me, unless you're cutting up your machine with your rotary, or your machine, your quilt with your rotary cutter, there's not many ways of ruining your quilt, really. You might do a job you're not super happy with. You might do a job where you don't like the design you put on and you take all the stitches out. I've been there. I've done that with a lap size quilt that I'd done on my long arm. I took all the stitches out and re-quilted it. Yeah, takes a long time to do that when you've long-armed it, let me tell you. Quick to long arm, long time to pick out stitches. But was I happier the second time around? Yes, I was. Could I have left it the first time? Sure, why not? But learning, right, as you go along. So don't start on that great quilt top that you put all those hours into, you know. Don't start on a present you're making for someone's 50th anniversary, okay? Let's start small. I always say, no matter what technique you're working on, when you're learning something new, start small, okay? Because two reasons. First off, you're learning. It's going to take you longer. You may get frustrated. You may get bored. Think about it. If you started your first quilt project with a queen size quilt, you might have quit quilting right then and there, right? Like you might have said, oh my God, this is going to take forever. I'm not going to, you know, I don't want to spend all the time on this. So starting with a smaller project allows you to get through it quicker, to be more successful with it. And if for some reason, not with free motion quilting, but for another technique, if you don't like it, you haven't spent a lot of time and money on it, okay? But that's not free motion quilting because you're going to like it, right? You're going to like it. So what do I suggest you do? Well, there's a couple options. So you can take a couple of fat quarters, and I suggest you take some solid fabrics for a couple reasons. First off, you want to see your stitches, right? And you can't really see them very well if it's on a patterned fabric. And you want to also, not only do you want to see your stitches as far as the stitch length and that, because you're trying to get in the same stitch length in all your stitches eventually. When you're free motion quilting, that's kind of the goal. But you also want to use a thread on the top and one on the bottom that are two different colors. So you want to use a thread in your bobbin that's maybe a bright pink, and one in the top that's a bright aqua, let's say. And so then you can also check your tension as you go along. And again, that would be very difficult to see on a patterned fabric. Okay, so take a couple of fat quarters, cut some batting to put in the middle as well. Okay, sandwich them together. Okay, and if you're not already using my multi-purpose quilt spray to do that, I'll put a link underneath the video when we're done here so you can get that and use that. I know Rob uses it, so it works really well. It's a spray you can make yourself, and you can spray baste your quilt so much quicker. Saves so much time, and you don't have to worry about those pins picking you either. Hate those. Plus, you don't have to take pins out as you're quilting along, which I also hated. Never knew when to take those pins out exactly. How close did you have to get? Oh, too close, caught on your foot, right? Ever happened to you? Yeah. Okay, anyway, getting back to that quilt sandwich that you're going to make. And then you're just going to start with some simple designs on it. Just start playing around with it. Don't try and do anything too fancy or anything. You're just trying to get that balance, you know, between your how fast your hands are moving, how fast the needle's going up and down. You want to check your tension, see how that's going, and make little adjustments as you go along. So it's a practice sandwich. So I have several practice sandwiches. I don't have one at hand here right now, but I have several practice sandwiches that I've used over the years. And I keep them by my sewing machine, and I keep using them to test my thread tension or even, you know, a design I'm working on to get me warmed up. It's like a warm-up, right? Just like you stretch before you start exercising, before you start running or anything. You do some stretches or you warm yourself up. Same thing when you're free motion quilting. You want to warm those little muscles up and get your mind into it and everything too. So I keep those practice sandwiches by the machine. I practice on them when I'm starting a real quilt, right? And as I said, if you have this solid color on the fat quarters, you're going to be able to check your tension easily. You're going to be able to see the design. And because we usually use different colored threads on different projects, you're not always going to be using the same color thread on every project. Usually you can see your stitches fairly well, even if there's lots of other free motion quilting already on that practice sandwich. Okay, so practice. It's a practice sandwich, right? Practice. And how often should you practice? Well, as often as you can. Okay, so if you have it by your machine and you can sit down and do 15 or 20 minutes a day, and I got to admit, I'm not great at that. Okay, I will admit that right now. But man, when I sit down and start doing that and spend some time in a few days in a row, it's amazing how much you improve. Like 15, 20 minutes a day consecutively, you'll see a huge improvement. And so that's really what you need to do is practice, 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 right? If someone ever comes up with some way to get good at free motion quilting without practice, oh my gosh, that person will make $1 million because, you know, everybody tells you you have to practice and everybody goes, you know. But think of it in small chunks. Think 15 or 20 minutes a day. It's not like hours and hours and hours every day. And speaking of that, hours and hours every day, if you are a long-arm quilter, you are spending hours and hours every day quilting because that's your job, right? You're standing at your machine, you're quilting. Now, they're probably not quilting all day long because long-arm quilting can be kind of tough on your back and knees and feet. But anyway, they are quilting several hours every day, let's just say, all different designs, right, using different threads. And they get good at it, don't they? Sure they do. They get good at it because they put in the practice, okay? They started the same place you did at the beginning, but they practice and they continue to practice and they get better and they get better and they try new designs and they try more complicated designs and they try things they haven't tried before because they're not afraid of free motion quilting because they love free motion quilting. And I've got to say, I belong to a long arm quilting group here in Calgary and their work is absolutely amazing. I'm never sure whether to be upset or inspired when I look at their things, but I take it as inspiration. And so that brings me to another point. Don't compare your beginning to somebody else's middle, okay? So when we look at some of the quilts we see online that are done by people who are professional quilters, you know, Angela Walters, Claudia File, Sue Patton if you're in Canada, and you look at their designs and their quilts and their quilting, and you're like, oh my gosh, how does she do it? Well, you know how she does it is because she spent years practicing, okay? And you can be that good too someday if you want to put in the practice time. So it's up to you which way you want to go. And like I said, if you want to get good, you got to practice. If you don't like free motion quilting, I can't imagine, but if you don't like free motion quilting, you can pay somebody. And there's nothing wrong with that. Some people like to do the piecing and they don't like the quilting part. Or they like to do the applique and they don't like the quilting part. Nothing wrong with taking that and asking a long armer to quilt it for you. Because I guarantee you they're going to do an amazing job. And you know what that does? It frees you up to make more quilt tops. So if you don't want to get into free motion quilting, no judgment, you know, but I hope you at least give it a little bit of a try and see what you think about it. So back to our practice sandwich. What are you going to do with your practice sandwich when it's all filled up? Well, quilters are pretty practical, so you don't want to just throw it away. I know some people who throw away projects that they're never going to finish or things like that. I just couldn't do that, so I don't throw my practice sandwiches away either. As a matter of fact, I just keep practicing and practicing and practicing on them, and in my studio, I use them for kind of some weird stuff maybe, but they will cover up things in my studio that I don't want the cats to get into because, you know, the cats are always in my studio. So I can use them as that, or I can use them as a cat blanket. Right? So you can bind them, gives you some practice binding, and you can use them as a cat blanket or a dog blanket. Or there's other ideas. Just recently, some people were commenting on my Facebook page. I think it was in the group. I'm not sure which, but they were commenting and saying what else they use things for. One lady used them for to give to new moms as like burp cloths. who would have thought? I wouldn't have thought about that. But I'm like, oh yeah, great, because they'll absorb things, won't they? Yeah, no problem. And you can wash them easily. How about using them for, let's see, what was the other person? I was trying to think what somebody else said. There was some other interesting comment. I'm losing my train of thought on that one right now. But there was something else too. Oh, pot holders. That's what it was. Pot holders. Great for pot holders, right? If it gets stained or dirty or whatever, it doesn't really matter. You can wash it if you want, or at that point in time, you could chuck it out, right? So I thought that was kind of cool too. One of my friends will actually take the practice sandwiches she has and she cuts them up and uses them like fabric, if you will, and makes like bags and little purses and things like that for people who are not quilters and don't know the difference. They just see all the stitching all over it. They think it looks great. So there's another interesting idea for those practice sandwiches. So don't think about them as being, you know, wasting your fabric or your batting. I know sometimes we think that. Think about them as helping you improve your free motion quilting, and think about you can use them for all these different reasons or different things later on. Sorry, TK, I thought it was going to run at me here for a second. So there's lots of different things you can do with these. So I hope that you are thinking about free motion quilting in a bit of a different light now. I hope you have a good attitude towards it, because again, if it's quilting, new techniques you're learning quilting, or even things that you that come across your life, you know, different things we don't like to do or we're a little afraid of doing, that type of thing. If you have the attitude that, sorry, there's Tika again. Tika. Tika's not listening to me well today, apparently. If you have the attitude that you're, you know, interested, excited, open to what that may mean to you once you get past that stumbling block of fear, right, you would be amazed how well things work out. So again, when you sit down to free motion quilt, I want you to have a few things in your mind. I want you to think about the fact that you're starting at the beginning. Sorry, guys. Tika. Oh my goodness. Okay. It's getting close to feeding time. That's why she's making all this racket. So again, let's go back. When you're talking about free motion quilting, I want you to keep some things in your mind. I want you to realize that you're starting at the beginning. Okay, so everybody starts at the beginning, and you know what the best part about starting at the beginning is? There's nowhere to go but up, right? There's only getting better, right? So you're going to start at the beginning. You're going to realize that your first efforts are going to be, let's just call them, ugly. Okay, they're not going to be great. Your tension may not be good. Your stitches won't be the same length. Your, you know, circles are not going to be circular. They're going to be jagged looking, okay? That's okay. That's exactly what you want to see. That's how it's going to work. And if you don't have any of those issues, even better, okay? As you go along, you're going to get better. You will definitely get better. And practice makes improvement, okay? It's not perfection. Practice makes improvement. And with practice, you will improve. There's no doubt about it, okay? And no comparison to others. I talk about this a lot because I know we often compare our work to other people's. The only person you should be comparing yourself to is the work you did yesterday or last week or last year. Again, think back to that first quilt you made and what was it like, and would it look different if you made it now? I imagine it would, right? Because you have all this practice, experience, skill behind you now. Okay, so I want you guys to go out, if you haven't done anything free motion quilting wise for a while, or you're still a little nervous about that, I want you to take a look at the YouTube video I posted this week. And over the next few weeks, I'm going to be focusing on free motion quilting. And actually in the Quilter's Way, we have different themes each month. And October is free motion quilting month. So we're going to be going deep into free motion quilting in that group. Again, if you want to take a look at it, go to thequiltersway.com. And I want you to get out some fat quarters. I want you to get some batting. I want you to get your machine set up. And as I said, I'll put some information, I'll put the links to my YouTube video, the multipurpose quilt spray, I'll put links to some of the other items I was talking about underneath this, in the comments underneath this video, so you can see what I'm talking about. And I want you to start free motion quilting. I want you to just get in there, give it a go, and if you haven't free motion quilted, if you've already done some and you haven't for a while, get that practice sandwich set up. Start making a cat blanket. Okay? So, if you're going to do that, give me a yes in the chat, because I want to see who's going to do that. And I just want to go back now and see, we have people from Norway here, Indiana, Ohio, Quebec, bonjour, Of course, Rob from the Netherlands, Dan Lee, just to the east of me here, Southern California, I should say. Got people all over the place today, don't we? Yes, and so Cindy's saying she's done some small projects with free motion quilting, right? Ornaments, straight line quilted with and without a walking foot. That's another one too, right? That's what she's saying here, if you can see her comments here. Wants to do free motion quilting on quilts. Yes, so walking foot quilting is another way to get into it. That's not free motion quilting, of course, but it's another great way to start, for sure. Veronica, hello. And yes, I'm getting lots of yes, 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 yes as well. So yes, if you are wanting to do free motion quilting, there's nothing stopping you. Just think you're going to make mistakes. Just get in there and start it, because typically the fear of doing something is worse than, you know, when you actually get in and do it. And after a while, you're going to say, what was I so afraid about? Why did I hesitate to do this? I should have done this years ago, right? Don't we all say that? I say that about quilting. I should have started a long time ago because I love it, right? And I'm sure you all do as well. So, as I said, I got more YouTube videos coming out about free motion quilting. I'm going to put some links in about the previous ones about how to set up your machine and other information I talked about today. And then the next time I'll see you guys will be in October. Oh my gosh. Can you believe it? I can't even believe we're in September, but October. So until then, practice some free motion quilting. If you're in my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, or you're on my page, put up some photos. I want to see what you're doing. I want to see some of your attempts. And if you have any questions, of course, you can always reach out in any of those areas to me so I can help you as well. Thanks again for watching me today and spending time with me. I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day, and I hope you do some free motion quilting. All right. Bye now. We'll see you in a month.